First of all, thank you, Anits, and the program coordinator for giving me an opportunity to discuss about blockchain technology fundamentals. I will be taking two sessions. So in the first session, I will be covering blockchain technology fundamentals. And in the next session, I will be giving an online session and hands-on session on smart contract development and deployment. And also like some more details regarding the Ethereum blockchain. Before continuing with my presentation, let me show you a small motivation, like why we need to study blockchain or why we need to know about the blockchain. You might be hearing like in the news or in the newspapers, you might be hearing like Bitcoin price is going more, Ethereum price is going more, like lot of market cap is available for the cryptocurrencies. So many people are investing in cryptocurrencies. So first of all, let us look, see, these are the top 10 cryptocurrencies currently in the market. If you can see Bitcoin, it's the first public blockchain network. You can see it has a market cap of $879 billion, and the second most market cap blockchain is Ethereum, which is having a market cap of more than $462 billion. So this much money people are investing into these networks. And you can see also the daily transaction volume is also more. It is like $35 million for Bitcoin and $26 million for Ethereum. So why this much money is poured into the public blockchain networks, or why many people are becoming increasingly investing in these networks? So there is something in these networks like which we as a common people are not understanding. And as a computer science students, like or a computer science people, we should have some understanding of these blockchain networks. So like this will be like a motivation, like so people are investing so much money into it, and it is related to computer science, so we should know some fundamentals regarding this blockchain networks. So my talk will be like today, in the first session, I will be discussing the fundamentals, the actual core technology behind these public blockchain networks. So if you have at any moment of time, if you have any doubts, please raise your hand and ask, so you can interrupt me in the presentation itself, so I can then and there can clarify your doubts. So what is a blockchain? So the definition is very simple. You can see it is only of two lines. So what is a blockchain? It's an open distributed ledger that records a transaction between two parties in a verifiable and immutable way. You can see, I will get the keywords from here. You can see open is one keyword, and there is a meaning for each and every keyword here. So the first one is open, the second one is distributed, third one is verifiable, and fourth one is immutability. So these are the four keywords, and these four keywords has lot of meaning involved with them, and lot of technologies are required to achieve these four properties, that is open, distributed, verifiable, and immutable. So I repeat, so if anybody asks you what is a blockchain, it is very much simple. You can say, oh, it is an open distributed ledger which records transaction between two parties in a verifiable and immutable way. So my entire talk will be based on this definition. So I will be explaining what is open, what is distributed, what is verifiable, and what is immutable, and the core technologies behind these four keywords, so that we can get a strong understanding of what is blockchain and what is the technology behind blockchain. So some more details. Again, what is a blockchain? You can say people when you say
sorry, I interrupt you, sir. So why researcher suddenly moved into blockchain concept? Before that, what are the challenges faced by early researchers?
It's a good question. See, you all know like 2008, the crisis. I think many of people have had that financial crisis in 2008. So why that happened? Basically, there is a company called Lehman Brothers in USA. So it has given so many loans to the people and it failed to recollect those loans. The similar thing happened recently in China also. Okay, so these public, these banks, the investor banks has so much control with them. So they have the people's money, they have distributed uncontrollably. So what happened? They couldn't recollect and they have bankrupt. So some person, a person called, or we don't know, a group of person called Satoshi Nakamoto, he decided why a centralized system should have control over our assets. So why should we give control to a centralized system like a bank? Here also in India, in 2016, Narendra Modi, our Honorable Prime Minister, what he did simply demonetization. Okay, what happened? So all the legal tenders doesn't have any value at that point of time. So how he has done that? Because he has control or he has power to do it. So power lies in a single hand, whether it is bank or a government or it is some also a private bank. So power lies with these banks or centralized peoples. But the assets are us, money belongs to us. So why the money belongs to us should have a control or power with some other persons, some centralized or this public persons. So from that idea, this blockchain was born. So from that idea, this blockchain was formed. So the core philosophy of this blockchain is no centralization, no third parties. The people who owns the assets or money should openly, in a distributed, immutable and verifiable way, a person should transfer his assets or his money to another person. So that was the whole motivation behind this blockchain. That was the motivation behind Bitcoin. Okay, but the underlying technology, the blockchain technology, it has more power. It is more powerful than the Bitcoin itself. So I will be discussing one by one. So first I will be discussing blockchain and then Bitcoin, and I will show how a centralized system, what properties the blockchain system will give when compared to a centralized system. Okay. So the question is like, why researchers moved? Because it's a research concept. So blockchain is a product of years of research in computer science. I will tell you what are the technologies behind the blockchain. I will also tell you how they correspond to the blockchain. So let me go through this slide. So what is a blockchain? Again,
and one more question, sir, regarding the distributed ledger. So how it was it is differ from the traditional databases very often used by computer science researchers? How it is a differ distributed ledger database?
I will be coming to that. So I have a slide for that. So so again, so if you thought of blockchain, many people thinks like cryptocurrency and many people think like a lot of money involved in that. But blockchain can be used for both financial and non-financial transaction. Every digital asset can be stored and can be represented in a blockchain. It has nothing to do with financial things. So both financial and non-financial things can be stored in a blockchain. And blockchain, again, it is a distributed, it is replicated across several systems in a peer-to-peer network. And every node in a blockchain contains a copy of it. So unlike the centralized systems, or if you take, for example, a bank has its own digital ledger. So that ledger will not be shared with you or me. Okay, only the bank will have it, or some few peers related to the bank can read or write into that ledger. However, if it is a blockchain, everybody have the same copy of the ledger, and when and where the updates are received, that updates are updated into a ledger. Then, so again, I'm comparing to a bank. So if the bank has a ledger, so who can modify that ledger? Only the bank can modify the ledger. However, suppose bank has like accidentally transferred you 1 lakh rupees, okay, or something happened and it doesn't want to, it want to like override the existing records, it can do, it has that power to do. But it with a blockchain, so nobody, once a transaction is finalized, nobody can change the transaction, nobody can change the finality of the transaction. So that is what blockchain, and how nobody can change, I will discuss that. And then the lot of the computer science research, mainly the computer science security research, the primitives like cryptography, digital signatures are all incorporated into the blockchain to get the properties like identity, authenticity, and also to enforce read and write access. And so we all, if you talk about blockchain, we start with 2008 Bitcoin Satoshi Nakamoto, but the history of blockchain has started long back. Like in 1991 itself, the concept of blockchain is proposed by Stuart Haber and Scott. Like, not exactly the blockchain, they have not coined the term blockchain. Even Satoshi Nakamoto has not coined the term blockchain, okay? Only the people who read that white paper by Satoshi Nakamoto has derived this concept, like blockchain. There is actually no term blockchain associated with Bitcoin white paper. Okay, it is derived later by some of the researchers. But the similar concept is explained in 1991 by Stuart Haber and Scott. That is called as a cryptographically secured chain of blocks. Like, they just, I will show what is this cryptographically secured chain. But this concept has proposed in 1991. And later, the same people has incorporated Merkle trees with this, because Merkle trees has will take low storage, and also it is used for verifying the data. So they have incorporated this. And then Hal Finlay. So this Hal Finlay is rumored to be Satoshi Nakamoto. Like 90% of the chances, like Hal Finlay can be Satoshi Nakamoto, but nobody knows who is Satoshi Nakamoto. He has proposed this reusable proof of work. Basically, it's a digital cash system. It is most close to Bitcoin. However, in this digital cash system proposed by Hal Finlay, he doesn't have this blockchain concept or the chaining, cryptographical chaining concept. And then in 2008, after this financial crisis or during this financial crisis, a person named Satoshi Nakamoto or a group of people, we don't know who exactly is, has coined or proposed this Bitcoin white paper. And initially proposed it as a white paper, later a group of people has developed it into a software that is called as a Bitcoin D client, and then the journey of Bitcoin started. So as I said, blockchain is not a one-day wonder, or it's not built in a one day. It's a, like, it's a combination of several technologies, and it's a byproduct of research, computer science research for the last like 30-40 years. Like it has incorporated like the research from the peer-to-peer networks, the research from public cryptography, and I said distributed ledger, that is like the 1991 Stuart Haber's concept. And then the consensus protocol, most probably one of the oldest branch in distributed systems, and then the smart contracts. So the blockchain is combination of all these technologies, okay? It's not a single like isolated technology. It's a combination of all these technologies. We all know, we all familiar is like with these terms. Like, we all know what is a peer-to-peer network, and we know public cryptography, and maybe most of you might not have this consensus protocols and smart contracts, but the first two has been will are familiarized for most of the people. So I will be discussing one by one what is this technology and how this is used in blockchain, and then I will be moving to the properties given by all these technologies. So first, what is a peer-to-peer network? Like, You all know there are two types of network, a client-server model and a peer-to-peer networks. In a peer-to-peer network, there is no centralized authority. All peers will communicate among themselves. Okay, so each peer will forward the information to other peers. But what could be the advantages? As I said, the first advantage is there is no centralized authority here. There is no single point of failure also. So that gives you decentralization. And as there is no single point of failure, every peer is available. If even if one peer is down, the other peers are available. Okay, that means it can provide high availability. And we know that centralized systems or single point of failure systems are susceptible to DOS attacks. However, a peer-to-peer network is immune to DOS attacks. For example, a DOS attack has happened at this peer. Okay, only this peer will be affected. All other peers in the network are available and they can service the request. And then as there is no centralized authority, there is no censorship. So they can freely distribute whatever transactions or whatever material they want among themselves, they can freely distribute among themselves as there is no censorship involved with the centralized authorities. The examples are, you know, this Nutella is a famous file sharing software built on this peer-to-peer systems, and Napster is also like a famous peer-to-peer system primarily built for sharing music. And we know BitTorrent, most of the people are using BitTorrent, but it is a product, it is built on peer-to-peer network to transfer large files. And then Skype. So Skype, like people are using it every day, but the Skype also built on peer-to-peer networks for VoIP calls. Okay, so blockchain or any blockchain network is primarily built on peer-to-peer network. The base layer for any blockchain network is a peer-to-peer network. So this eliminates central authorities and it will also provide decentralization. And the second well-known technology is public key cryptography. We have been like public key cryptography is there for the last 40 years. Okay, so blockchain also incorporates this public key cryptography. Like for example, every peer or every identity, or for example, every person who want to transact in a blockchain network should have a public private key pair. You all know what are the properties we will get with public private key pair. So if you have a public private key pair, you can either encrypt some data or you can digitally sign some data. Okay, but mostly you will use this public private key pair in blockchain for two things. One is for identities and the second is for digital signatures. Okay, so a public key is used to identify a peer uniquely in a blockchain network. So for example, you have a bank account. So what is your unique identity? Your account number. Okay, and account number is linked to your KYC forms. But however, in blockchain, there is no KYC and there is no account numbers. You are known by only your public key. So, and that public key is associated with a private key. So why private key is used? Suppose you are having some assets on the blockchain or some money, for example, like Bitcoins you are having. You want to transfer your Bitcoins to some other person. So what generally happens? You need to sign the transaction with your private key. Then only that the people can verify that those Bitcoins belong to you and you are eligible to transfer those Bitcoins to some other persons. Okay, so but this private key can be used to transfer both financial and non-financial assets. So there is no names, there is no KYC in the blockchain, only you have a public address. So all your money or assets are registered under your public key, and once you want to transfer your assets, those should be signed with your private key. So this is what public key cryptography, the role of public key cryptography in a blockchain network. And the other cryptography elements is the cryptographic hash functions. So you all know what is a hash function. Okay, I'm not explaining what is a hash function. I assume that you all know what is a hash function. So, but the I will go through only the properties of a hash function. So we all, hash function is a one-way function. Like given, suppose there is some data, some x, given x, okay, if you run a hash function on that, you will get y. So given y, you cannot get x. Okay, that is what a one-way function. And collision resistance, like for every pair of data, like x and y, you should get a different hash value as an output. So no two data have the same hash. And determinism, so it should always produce a constant length of the hash value. The hash function should always produce a constant hash value. And non-predictability is like, so before applying the hash function, okay, the we cannot predict the output of that hash function. So that is what non-predictability. And the most important property is the avalanche effect. Like even if one bit differs in the input, the output should differ greatly. So you might have studied this avalanche effect when you are studying AES or DES algorithms also. So even if there is one bit change in the input, the output, the output will drastically change. So these are the properties of cryptographic hash function, but how these are used in the blockchain. Okay, so this is how these are used in the blockchain. So I said, once you put the data into the blockchain, it is immutable, like nobody can change it. Why nobody can change it? I will come to that why part, but what happens if they change it? Okay, so for that we will use Merkle trees. So for example, this is the data, okay, and these are the hash functions which has the properties discussed previously. So I will construct a tree such that all the leaf nodes are the datas. It's like simple, a binary tree, okay, and I will repeatedly hash this data until I reach a root node. So this is called as a Merkle root. So what this Merkle trees will give me, it will give me three important properties. The first one is data integrity. So for example, in this transaction 2, I change a single bit, okay, so now this hash will be changed, this hash will be changed, and the root hash will be changed drastically. So if I store this Merkle root in my local system and somebody has changed this transaction 2, a single bit, and they have computed this Merkle root, and the Merkle root which I have stored is drastically different from the Merkle root that is computed by the other person. So by comparing that, I can know that the data has been modified. Although I don't know what data has been modified or what bit has been modified, but I can know that the data is modified. That property is called as data integrity. And the second thing is efficient verification. Okay, so I have a Merkle root. I have to verify whether this transaction 2 has been there in that Merkle root or not. So what I need? I need this hash 1, hash 0, 1, and Merkle root. So I don't want to, I need not to bother about this part of the tree. So only with few verification steps, I can verify whether the transaction is a part of that Merkle tree or not. That is what efficient verification. And the next one is space efficient. So generally, if you have the Merkle trees, you need not to store the data. You can always verify whether the data exists with that Merkle root or not by going through the tree. And how this Merkle trees are related to the blockchain? As I said, the data in the blockchain is immutable. That means nobody can change the data. Okay, that why part I will discuss, but what if anybody changes it? We can easily detect by using the Merkle trees or the Merkle root. And distributed ledger, the third major technology in the behind blockchain is distributed ledger. Okay, so we all know our banks have a ledger, or in fact every shop, like, or every like financial party maintains a ledger, but that ledger is centralized to them or some peers, okay, related to them. However, what is a distributed ledger? It can contain anything, a transactions, a financial transaction, non-financial transactions, or contracts. But the major difference is the ledger is stored in a decentralized fashion across different locations and peers. I'm only talking about distributed ledger. I'm not talking about the distributed ledger in blockchain. Okay, so the normal distributed ledger is like it is maintained in a decentralized fashion at different locations and peers. And the next thing is, like, every peer in the network has an access to that information. It's not like only some people should read it. Okay, there is no access controls, read access controls. At least there can be write access controls, which we will discuss, but the currently there is no read access controls, and no single peer can unanimously or single-handedly change the data or can control the data. Everybody has any equal rights to control that data. Okay, this is what a distributed ledger. But the distributed ledger can be of many types. Okay, blockchain is a specific type of distributed ledger where the data is stored in form of blocks. Okay, and each block is cryptographically chained to its parent block. So this is just a normal distributed ledger. It can be spread across several locations and peers, and the properties, no, everybody can read the data, but nobody can. Of the distribution, what is a distributed ledger in blockchain? It is like set of blocks such that each block is cryptographically chained to its parent block. What is this cryptographical chaining? As I said, hash functions in the previous slides. So the hash of this block, okay, the hash of this blocks means I will discuss the block structure when I'm discussing Bitcoin, but currently let us think some data is stored in this block. So the hash of this block is stored in this block, the hash of this block is stored in this block. So if any malicious person want to change some data in this block, he has to change this block and this block, because the new block will be added here. Okay, so it is simple for anybody to change, like, only this hashes, right? We need to recompute the hash. But however, there is something called consensus algorithm which prevents changing of this data. Okay, I'll discuss. Okay, but I think you're clear with what is distributed ledger and the difference between a normal ledger and a distributed ledger and the distributed ledger in blockchain. So till now I say blockchain as a distributed ledger, like, till now all these slides have discussed the capital B blockchain as a distributed ledger. However, a small correction, like, generally we will represent a distributed ledger as a blockchain with small b and the blockchain network, whole blockchain network, with a capital B. That includes the blockchain ledger, blockchain network, the distributed ledger, and the consensus algorithm. So just a small correction, like, there is no standards. Basically, some people follow, so different people follow different standards. So what is consensus algorithm? This is the, like, primary novelty of the Bitcoin, frankly speaking. Okay, but the consensus algorithm research is there from 1980, like, people started to think about multiprocessor or distributed systems. Okay, people are exploring consensus algorithms. So it is one of the oldest and most researched area in computer science. Okay, so what is the consensus algorithm? Okay, for example, there are some 10 people sitting on a they are on a, in a boardroom, and they are discussing some matter, but at the end of the meeting they need to reach some conclusion. Okay, so the achieving the conclusion the process of achieving that conclusion is called as consensus algorithm. Okay, now how it is related to computer science? Suppose there are like distributed processors or distributed systems, like there are 10 systems at different locations. Okay, they all need to agree on a data variable. They all need to agree on a variable's value, for example. How can they agree on a variable value? That is what the process is called as consensus algorithm. Okay, generally consensus algorithm are used to achieve some common agreement between mutually untrusted entities or peers. So as I said, if it is a boardroom, then everybody known to everyone. There is no problem with that. Let me tell you one more example. Like there are, you know, this Byzantine generals problem. Okay, there is an empire called Byzantine, and that Byzantine has several generals who want to attack this Ottoman empire. So these generals like are situated at different locations. Okay, one general cannot see the another general, but they need to attack this Ottoman empire on an exact date and exact time. And there are some malicious generals in this set of generals. Okay, so even though there are malicious generals, they need to get a conclusion on what time and what date they need to attack this Ottoman empire. This is called as a Byzantine generals problem, very famous problem in distributed systems. And they have actually several versions of this problem, and they have solutions also. That is called as a practical Byzantine fault tolerance, where it says like there is first formula 3f plus n equals to 3f plus 1. So if the number of nodes is n and the number of malicious nodes is f, it should have n equals to 3f plus 1 nodes at least to get a consensus on the date and time to attack. Okay, the similar consensus is needed in the blockchain system. Why? Because is here also everybody having a distributed ledger with them, and some data, so everybody is having this distributed ledger, and a new block has to be added here. So in order to add a new block, everybody should agree on that block. Then only everybody can add that block to their distributed ledger. If there is no mechanism in place that to get on what contents should go on to the next block, then everybody have a different distributed ledger and everybody have different contents. So there should be some common agreement, like there should be some process should go on to produce the next block or to produce what goes into a distributed ledger. So there are several kinds of consensus algorithms before blockchain, like, or before Bitcoin. So these are the famous consensus algorithms like PBFT, Paxos, and Raft. And the major innovation of Bitcoin is proof of work. And then, like, there are some limitations with proof of work I will discuss. People have been exploring other consensus algorithms like proof of stake, delegated proof of stake, and some proof of authority. And there are several, like there are like at least 100 consensus algorithms. Okay, I have listed only few. And the last major technology behind this blockchain is smart contracts. So what is a smart contract? Like, we all write programs in Java or in some kind of language, though. And we all know there will be contracts, like a legal contract. Maybe most of you people have seen the legal contract. But what is a smart contract? Okay, codifying the rules of a legal contract as a program is nothing but a smart contract. So a smart contract is a program that will run on a blockchain network. So what this program can contain? It can contain several rules coded into them. Okay, so that is what the smart contract can contain, many contract-led clauses. In the afternoon session, I will be showing how to write a smart contract and how to deploy it in a Ethereum network. Okay, so similar to a transaction, a smart contract is also executed by miners. So I will again explain what is, who is a miner and what is mining in the coming slides. But till now, you just think that smart contracts are also executed by miners or nodes. Okay. So if we assume that consensus algorithm is secure, then this smart contract can be thought of a program executed by a global trusted machine. I'll explain what is this, how we'll get this trusted global machine which can execute the smart contracts, which can execute the smart contracts trusted and faithfully. So if you have any doubts on this fundamental technologies, you can raise your hand or you can directly ask. So assuming there are no questions, I'm moving forward. So like, what are the properties a blockchain system will give when compared to a centralized system? Definitely the first one is decentralized system, because there is no central authorities who can control a blockchain system. Okay, how we have achieved this? Because of peer-to-peer network. And the second property is immutability. So once a data goes into a blockchain and it is finalized, it cannot be changed forever. Okay, assuming the consensus algorithm is secure. But when compared to the centralized system, yeah, anybody can change, who is having this write access can change the data in a ledger. Okay, I think you can all agree with that point. And the third property a blockchain system gives us is transparency. Like, all transactions are publicly available in a distributed ledger. But is there a transparency with the centralized systems? I don't think so. For example, nobody can see your bank records or somebody. Everything is like untransparent. Like, the ledgers are behind some walls. Okay, that is what I can say for a centralized system. And the fourth is persistency. So once a data goes into the blockchain, and the next one is public auditability. So anybody can verify any transactions, whether it is correct or not correct. Okay, so everybody has an equal power to verify a transaction. That is what public auditability. And privacy. So blockchain system, the initial public blockchain systems like Bitcoin, Ethereum are not suited for privacy. They cannot provide at all. See, the transparency and privacy cannot go, cannot be together. So if transparency is there, there is no privacy. If privacy is there, there is no transparency. But however, with the help of something called zero knowledge proofs, okay, we are achieving both privacy and transparency. But that is still in an infancy stage. Like, from last 2 years, people are working on zero knowledge proofs, and people are working zero knowledge proofs on blockchain. So that will give you a privacy. And the last one, last property, is programmability. So anybody can write their own smart contracts that can be executed on a blockchain network in a transparent and trustful way. So these are the properties which are offered by blockchain system when compared to the centralized systems. So now I think you can realize how blockchain is different from a centralized system. So I just kept, generally people will keep this slide as a first slide, but I wanted to explain what is blockchain first, and then I want to explain the difference between centralized system and blockchain system. For example, if this is a centralized system, everybody have their own ledgers and everybody will communicate. Okay, for example, here bank is a central authority for all these three parties, and auditor is a central authority for all these three parties. Okay, so although it looks like a peer-to-peer network, it is not really a peer-to-peer network, because everybody have their own records and nobody can share, or nobody can read or write the other party's records. And here you will have the KYCs, the identities. Okay, and people are known here. But coming to your blockchain system, so everybody have, although everybody have their own shared ledger, you can see here everybody is having a ledger. However, this ledger will, everybody have the common view, everybody have the same ledger with them. And if party A modifies this ledger, that will be reflected to all other three parties. Or if an auditor changes this ledger, that will be reflected to all other parties. So they have the common view of this ledger and what this ledger can contain, financial or non-financial transaction, and how this ledger is. It is a set of blocks such that each block is cryptographically linked to its previous block. And the only question is, who can add a block here? Okay, that is been proposed by a consensus algorithm. So all parties will participate in a consensus algorithm, and that notion, who can add a block here, will be coming from consensus algorithm, and I will be explaining that clearly when I talk about Bitcoin. So these are the properties proposed given by a blockchain system, and these are the this is the difference between a blockchain and centralized system. So before moving to Bitcoin, like if you have any doubts, like how still if you have, don't have any clarity on how centralized system is different from a blockchain system, you can ask quickly. Okay, I assume there are no doubts. Okay. Let me move to Bitcoin. So what is a Bitcoin? Is Bitcoin the blockchain, or is the blockchain is the Bitcoin? So many starters have this problem. Is Bitcoin is the blockchain, or is the blockchain is the Bitcoin? Okay, so Bitcoin is the first blockchain application. Even as I said earlier, even the Satoshi Nakamoto has not coined this term blockchain. People has derived the term blockchain from his ledger. So when Bitcoin is proposed, nobody have the idea of blockchain. He has proposed blocks and chains differently in his white paper, but people has derived it as a blockchain, and people are exploring this blockchain. So I say Bitcoin is the first blockchain application. And there can be any number of blockchain applications, but all those applications will have these properties. Again, I say if it is a public blockchain. So what is a Bitcoin? As I said, every public blockchain system will have those five technologies incorporated into them. So out of those five, Bitcoin have a shared ledger concept, although I'm not discussing peer, I have not included peer-to-peer here, because that is a basis. Any public blockchain system works on only peer-to-peer networks. So apart from peer-to-peer, it has a distributed ledger, and some cryptographic primitives are incorporated into it, and it has a consensus algorithm. But the primary objective of the Bitcoin is a peer-to-peer digital or cryptocurrency payment system, where people can transfer some type of digital currency from their wallets to other wallets without any central authorities. That is the primary object of Bitcoin, like the primary objective of the Satoshi Nakamoto. He just wanted to create a peer-to-peer currency platform. Okay, he has not bothered about blockchain, smart contracts, and everything. He has just he was motivated to develop only this peer-to-peer digital currency platform. Okay, as I said, it is developed by a person, Satoshi Nakamoto, or we don't know whether he is a person or an anonymous group. So how this Bitcoin works? Okay, let me first give the analogy of our existing payment network. So what happens, like we all know, we are working with Google Pay or Phone Pay, the UPI transactions. What happens? So first you will create a UPI transaction that will go to your PSP, that is called as a payer PSP, and the payer PSP will forward it to NPCI, National Payments Corporation of India, and the settlements happens at NPCI, such that the NPCI informs again both the payer PSP and the payee PSP, and the payer PSP will inform you as a payer, and the payee PSP will inform the receiver. Okay, this is how what happens in a existing banking system. Or the frankly speaking, it's an UPI flow. Okay, but what happens in Bitcoin? For example, some person A want to send some money to B. Here, money in a Bitcoin system is Bitcoins. Okay, this is not the money what we are talking about. The money in a Bitcoin network is, so India as a network has the money rupee, and US as a network has the money dollar, or the globe as a network has the money dollar. The Bitcoin as a network has the money called currency called Bitcoins. Okay, so now A want to send some Bitcoins to B. So what happens generally? So the transaction is proposed. So the transaction is not finalized, just a transaction is proposed. Now, see, when I compare with the central system here, when you send a transaction, it is verified by your payer PSP as well as the NPCI. But who will verify your transaction in a Bitcoin? Like A sends money to B. Who will verify it? So who will verify it? There are some peers called miners. So these miners will compete to produce a new block. Okay, what does this block contains? All the verified transactions. So a miner will keep the transaction in a block if and only if it is verified and correct. And then the miner will propose a block. I will again come. What is this miner and how he is able to produce a new block and how he is putting the transactions? For time being, let us think there is a miner who will verify your transaction and he will produce a new block. And the block is broadcasted to every other node in the network. So once it is broadcasted to every other node, so all other nodes again verify that block. And if the block is correct and all the transactions in that block are correct, they will add it to their distributed ledger. So everybody is, as I said in the earlier, everybody has a distributed ledger. If you want to extend the distributed ledger by adding a new block, they will either produce a new block or receive the new blocks from other miners. Once they receive a new block from the other miners, they will verify the transactions and they will add that block to their local blockchain or distributed ledger if and only if all the transactions are correct. So now there is an X and there is a Y. So X is having a distributed ledger of 3 blocks. Y is having a distributed ledger of 3 blocks. Now there is a person, Z, is a miner who has produced this block and broadcast it to both X and Y. So both will add this new block to their distributed ledger such that all 3X, Y, and Z have the common view of this blockchain. So that is how they are achieving the common view. Although there is no centralized system, everybody have their own ledger. All are having a common view due to this process. Then, so after the block is broadcasted, it will be added locally to the local chains. And then the money. So there is no finality here. See, for example, I said settlement happens at NPCA, and NPCA will acknowledge both the payee and payer PSPs, but there is no acknowledgement here. So once the block with this transaction, A wants to send money to B, once this at least 50% of the nodes, then the transaction is final. So there is no acknowledgements here. There is no like the absolute finality. Okay. Or there is only partial finality till sometime after some time. Like if it is a Bitcoin, it is after 60 minutes, there will be a full finality. But how that finality comes, well, at least 50% of the nodes adds that block to their local blockchain. Then only that finality comes. So this is how this Bitcoin network works more clearly. So this is what the distributed ledger in a Bitcoin, not the blockchain. Okay, so there are two parts here. As I said, it's a block header and block transactions or block data. Okay, so you can see here, there are some chains. These are called cryptographic chains. So the block one's header's hash, or we can say, because the header is containing the Merkle root of all the transactions. So transactions are arranged as a data and a Merkle tree is constructed on those transactions. And there will be a Merkle root, which is included in the block header. So So now the first block's hash is included in the second block's header, and the second block's hash is included in the third block header. So by this way, we are forming a cryptographic chain. So if somebody has changed a single bit in the transactions in block one, so the Merkle root will change and the hash of the block will change, such that the hash in the block two will change, hash of block one and block two will change, and the hash of the block two will change, which will then should be reflected onto the block three. So if you see, if there are n blocks and the current head is at the k block, okay, so we need to, if there is some change at the nth block, we need to change all the n minus k blocks. Okay, it is difficult to change this, okay, to change why? Because there is something called proof of work. I will come to proof of work. So some detailed Bitcoin architecture here. So for example, I met some block n plus 2, suppose n plus x, I need to add a new block n plus x as a mining node. So I am a mining node. Okay, what I will do, I will listen for all the transactions. So what are these transactions? People sending money from one person to another person. Those are the transactions. Okay, so if people are sending bitcoins from them to others, that is one transaction. So all these transactions, if I am a mining node, I will listen to all these transactions, and I will keep all these transactions in something called a memory pool, and then I will bundle all these transactions and I will construct a Merkle tree. Okay, after I will construct the Merkle tree, and then I will also include the previous block. Suppose if I'm getting this n plus, the new block is n plus x, the hash of the n plus x minus 1, I will calculate it, and I will keep that hash in the new block's header. And the last thing is called as nonce. Although there is a spelling mistake here, there's a last thing called as nonce. So I need to compute this nonce. Okay, so the entire security, I said in from almost like from 30 minutes back, I am saying like nobody can change the data. Why? Because only due to this inclusion of this nonce. Okay, so what is this nonce? How a nonce is produced in a Bitcoin network? So I will come to that nonce, but the Bitcoin uses, I said there are so many consensus algorithms. Bitcoin uses a consensus algorithm called proof of work. So what is this proof of work? I also said, like in the Bitcoin network, everybody have a read access, but a write access has to be earned. That means adding a new block should be earned. So how that can be earned? By doing proof of work. Okay, so if a miner want to produce a new block, okay, what should he do? He should collect the transactions, he need to verify the transactions, he need to calculate the Merkle tree, and then he need to find the nonce. So after successfully finding the nonce, he need to broadcast this block to the network, and all the other nodes or all the other miners in the network verify this block, and all the transactions also verify all the transactions in the block. If all are correct, then only they will add this block to their local distributed ledger and continue on producing the next block. So finding a correct nonce is called as mining. That is what is called as a Bitcoin mining. We should only find this nonce. That is what Bitcoin mining. So what is this nonce space? That is 2 power, it is 32 bits. So there can be 2 power 32 values for this nonce. So how to produce a nonce? So there is no shortcut here. Miners will do brute force. They will start with 0 till 2 power 32. Okay, so first they will put 0 here and they will hash it, and then 1, they will hash it, and the resultant hash will be compared to something called a new parameter called target. So what is a target? So the hash should be, so the nonce is kept in the block header, and the hash is calculated. This hash should be less than target. Okay, so a miner need to find a nonce such that the hash of the block is less than some target. Again, what is the target? Target is just a 256 bit number. So target depends on something called difficulty. Again, this is one more term. So target is depends on difficulty. So what is, again, difficulty? Before that, I will discuss what is hash rate. So if I ask you, what is the hash rate? Okay, so the hash rate is how many hashes my machine can perform in a second, or how many hashes the Bitcoin network as a whole can produce in a second. If I say Bitcoin network as a whole can produce 10 trillion hashes per second. Okay, then if you have like your machine can produce 1 trillion hashes out of all the 10 trillion hashes, if your own machine can produce 1 trillion hashes, then you will have 10% probability of producing the next block. Okay, so this difficulty, like difficulty depends upon the total hash rate of the network. If people are adding more number of systems into the network, the difficulty will increase. That means the target will decrease. So if the target is decreasing, means we are decreasing the set space of this hash. So the resultant, so we need to hash this, right? After we need to brute force this nonce from 0 to 2 power 32, and we need to hash this. So the hash should be less than some target. So if the target is smaller, so the target set space is reduced. If the target set space is reduced, we need to do more number. The probability of getting the nonce, the hash less than this target will be reduced. Okay. So this is what mining means. Let me summarize this. Mining means finding a correct nonce, the nonce values from range 2, 0 to 2 power 32. Okay, such that the hash of this block should be less than some target. What is the target? Target is a 256 bit number that depends on difficulty. And again, what is difficulty? Difficulty is a parameter that depends upon the hash rate of the network. If more and more hash rate is added to the network, the target will be reduced. The target is reduced, if the difficulty is increased, the target is reduced. That means the set space of finding the hash is reduced. But how this difficulty is adjusted? So the Bitcoin, the consensus algorithm, proof of work algorithm, the Bitcoin proof of work algorithm is cleverly coded such that the algorithm itself adjusts this difficulty for every 2016 blocks. That is, like, one block is approximately 10 minutes. So the block production time in Bitcoin is approximately 10 minutes. Okay. And 2016 blocks means it is approximately equal to 2 weeks. So the difficulty is adjusted for every 2 weeks. So how this is adjusted? So I said the average block time for Bitcoin is 10 minutes. For example, in the past 2 weeks, the average block generation time is only 8 minutes. What does that mean? The hash rate of the network has been increased. So how to again make it to 10 minutes? We need to increase the difficulty. That means we need to decrease the target. Okay. So the difficulty is automatically adjusted. For example, in the last 2 weeks, the block generation time is 15 minutes. The average is 10, but the block generation time is 15 minutes. So that means there is only less computation power in the network. So we need to decrease the difficulty and increase the target. Increasing target means there is a lot of set space where we can find the hash easily. Okay. But see, as I said, in order to compute a single block hash, we need to perform, see, the size of this hash algorithm is, they use a kind of SHA-3 algorithm or KZAC 256. It is 256 bits. That means we need to perform 2 power 256 operations for producing a single, we need to search on this 2 power 256 set space for producing a single block. So a lot of computation is required. So if I change this block, again, I need to find a new nonce for this block, and again, I need to find a new nonce for this block. I need to put my efforts three more times. Okay. By that time, the other nodes in the network will already have gone to block 5. Again, I need to generate new nonce for 4 and 5. In order to change some data in the block 1, I need to perform these many of operations. Okay, that is definitely it huge time consuming as well as resource consuming. That is why I can confidently say once a data is placed into this Bitcoin blockchain, it cannot be changed. So why the miners, I said producing a new block is computationally heavy, but why does they do it? Okay, so you can see there are large Bitcoin mining rigs, mostly in China and some other South American countries. Okay, they put so much of investment, they will add so much of this hash rate power to the network. But why they will do? What are the benefits for a miner here? So for producing a new block, a miner will get block reward in the form of Bitcoin. So that is how Bitcoins are generated in the network. So initially when Bitcoin is launched, for every new block, there is something 50 Bitcoins are awarded. It is revised for every 4 years. Okay, in 2008 it was 50, 2012 it is 25 Bitcoins, and 2016 it is 12.5, 2020 it is like 6.75 or something. Okay, so now if you produce a new block, you will get a block reward of something like 6.75 Bitcoins, as well as you will get the transaction fees. So I have not discussed the transaction fees here. If A want to send some money to B, A can include some transaction fees. So those transactions, all the transaction fees in a block will go to the block producer, that is called miner. So these are the benefits for a miner. So I have given a small, I have also gone through the schedule. There is a specific session on only Bitcoin. So I have mostly covered the basics of Bitcoin. Okay, but I will leave or I will end this Bitcoin discussion with a small comparison table. So I have listed some, like, not top five, most famous blockchains, public blockchain systems. Okay, they all have these properties. What are the properties? Decentralization, transparency, and the other properties like smart contracts, immutability, persistency. Okay, they all have these properties, and these all constructed on the same technologies: peer-to-peer, public key cryptography, consensus, smart contracts, and distributed ledger. However, they mostly vary on the type of consensus algorithms they use. I have discussed Bitcoin, which will use proof of work as a consensus algorithm, and Ethereum will use a form of proof of work, not exactly the proof of work adopted by Bitcoin, and that is called Ethash. And currently they are moving to a new proof of new consensus algorithm, that is proof of delegated proof of stakes. And there are other, like Binance, like it is currently growing. Okay, it is also having huge market cap, which will use a consensus algorithm. Like it is also used DPoS plus something called proof of authority. And Solana, it is a new blockchain than all these blockchains. Okay, it uses something, a new consensus algorithm, proof of history. There are so many kinds of consensus algorithms. The main goal of this consensus algorithms is to provide immutability to the data stored in a ledger. So we can use different consensus algorithm to achieve that property. But there are so many limitations. For example, if it is proof of work, I said it will take 10 minutes to produce a new block. Okay, but the block size in Bitcoin blockchain is only 1 KB. So the number of transactions that go into a Bitcoin block is just 1 KB. That is limited. And the transactions per second is only very limited, like 5 to 6 transactions per second. When you compare it to Visa or MasterCard, they can process like 5,000 transactions per second. So So there are a lot of scalability issues with this proof of work consensus algorithm, and lot of for producing a single block, there we need lot of hashes to be generated. Okay, that means lot of computing is required. If lot of computing is required, lot of energy, that electricity is also required. So basically, all this energy wastage will happen with this proof of work. So we have this delegated proof of stake. It doesn't have anything called as mining. They have validators, but however, still it suffers with scalability. And proof of authority, okay, they don't have mining and they don't have this staking concept, but it suffers with some form of centralization. So there is no perfect consensus algorithm that is a fit for all the blockchains. So these blockchains want to achieve some goals, so they need to adopt a consensus algorithm, or they need to design a new consensus algorithm such that they will eliminate some limitations. At McKinley and Rice, we also involved in developing a new blockchain system with a new consensus algorithm, again, which will solve some of these limitations and have some other kind of limitations. So basically, these are the problems that are solved by Bitcoin in the absence of centralized trusted authority, that is double spending and immutable transactions record. I have explained already these two things. And these are the limitations of Bitcoin, or kindly, these are the limitations of proof of work, not exactly Bitcoin, the proof of work consensus algorithm. The scalability and the enrollment impacts, as I said, there is transparency. That means there is no privacy. And the current transaction fees for a Bitcoin transaction are so high that the normal persons like you and me cannot afford to send a transaction in a Bitcoin network. You can see one Bitcoin is equal to $50,000, more than $50,000. So like the transaction fees are so high, the normal persons cannot do any transactions. And the last and most important limitation is Bitcoin supports only a limited support for programmability. We cannot write like very good smart contracts, or we cannot write huge smart contracts on Bitcoin. Very limited for programmability. We can call the Bitcoin, there is a language, these transactions, the Bitcoin transaction has a language called Bitcoin scripts. Okay, so the opcodes in the Bitcoin scripts are very limited, like, and it is called as a Turing incomplete. It is not a Turing complete language. So if it is a Turing complete language, it will support a lot of operations. We know it's a microprocessor architecture. We know what are the operations that go into Turing complete instruction set. Bitcoin is a Turing incomplete instruction set. It cannot support a large number of operations.
Okay.
So these are some limitations of Bitcoin. And let me show some form of Bitcoin Explorer. So it's a Bitcoin Explorer. You can see here, these are the blocks. You can see all the parameters. I say nonce, so this is the nonce for this block. Okay, and I said miners will get a block reward. So this is the block reward. This is currently 6.25 Bitcoins per block. And this is the transaction fee received. And this is also goes to the miner. And this is the nonce. I said the block can be of 1 KB size. So this is the size of this block. And the Merkle root. So the Merkle root, it's a root of the Merkle tree constructed from all the transactions. So these are the transactions in this block. You can see all these transactions. If you apply this Merkle hash and construct a Merkle tree with that, this will be the root. Okay, even if one bit is changed in these transactions, this root will be changed. And the number of transactions in this block are this will vary. The maximum, this only, there is no limit on the number of transactions. There is only the limit on the size. Okay, and this is the height. That is the number of the block. I said I have shown you a figure of 3 blocks. So it is currently having 714,000 blocks, and the number of blocks constructed on this block are 1. And this is the hash of this block. It will be included into the next block. So this is about Bitcoin, and this is the miner. Via BTC is the miner who has produced this block. And these are all the transactions. So let me end here.